The community of Ding Ben Zai lies in the shadow of central Taiwan's Alishan mountain range. Immigrants from China settled the area from across the Taiwan Strait just over a century ago. Residents today are transforming their township into a mecca for eco-tourists eager to spy Taiwan's indigenous flying squirrels in the wild. How did they make it all happen? In years past, life was harsh and resources scarce in Taiwan's highlands. Hunting was essential to supplement dietary protein, and flying squirrel frequently garnished the family table. The three subspecies of flying squirrel, or Pteristidae in Taiwan, include the large Formosan giant and white-faced flying squirrels, and the smaller Formosan hairy-footed flying squirrel. Each lives only in Taiwan. Each is active in its own elevation range. The white-faced thrives at mid to high altitudes. The Formosan giant is active in low to mid elevations. And the Formosan hairy-footed has been recorded at all three altitudes. The Wildlife Conservation Act of 1989 ushered in a new era of wildlife conservation and an emphasis on maintaining species diversity and ecological balance. It also placed severe new restrictions on hunting. Through the decades and centuries, the wild face of Taiwan's mountains had changed and whole habitats were no longer. Life in the wild had changed drastically for Taiwan's once ubiquitous flying squirrels. Domestic flying squirrel research continues to face many unanswered questions. Grassroots efforts here at Ding Ben Zai, it is hoped, may help resolve at least some of these gaps in knowledge. The three communities in Chiayi County's Guanghua Village include Jiadongzai, Ganzaijai, and Ding Ben Zai. Ding Ben Zai's former name of Ding Pen Zai described its relatively higher position up the mountain at about 1,000 meters. Officials, however, miswrote the name on local records, writing the word idiot in place of the original basin. This gave the town its current name, which translated literally means abode of the ultra idiots. Ding Ben Zai was first settled some 120 years ago, with founding families engaged in paddy rice and bamboo shoot cultivation and papermaking. Today, farmers grow bamboo shoots along with betel nuts, oolong tea, and vegetables. Residents' attempts over the years to bring their isolated community into step with the rest of Taiwan invariably fell short. Still, Ding Ben Zai today is a rare example of authentic Taiwan, with its bamboo-walled houses, cobble pavement, and the island's tallest high-altitude stands of gnarled chinaberry trees. Unlike nearby areas already familiar to eco-tourists, Ding Ben Zai has a large secondary-growth deciduous forest of camphor and kusu, both important sources of food for wildlife. This forested upland also has been called Niaoshan, or Buffalo Hill. Niaoshan was where Ding Ben Zai folk used to pasture their water buffalo. The surrounding area here was all terraced field, and buffalo weren't needed for work after the paddies were planted. Everybody just set them loose to graze up there. To preserve and highlight their community's uniqueness, Ding Ben Zai residents founded the Ding Ben Zai Culture Association in 1995. It was chartered to preserve and promote traditional ways of life and to protect the area's rich but fragile ecology. Most animals in the wild hide when they see, hear, or get a whiff of people. But those here in Ding Ben Zai are different. They don't know to hide when they're spotted. They just stand there and stare back.
So we usually tell visitors here that we've got the stupidest animals anywhere. But I've got a feeling those animals are looking at us and thinking the same thing. Those stupid people, they're thinking. They've brought another herd of people for us to look at. The bucolic qualities that define Ding Ben Zai don't inhibit an eagerness to try new ideas. Intra-community dialogue resulted in an innovative flying squirrel conservation program that today supports Taiwan's highest concentration of these animals in the wild. Jia Shen Liu, once an enthusiastic hunter, has worked as a ranger and conservationist for nearly a decade. Our families hunted in this area for food from the Qing dynasty. Our generation now understands the value of wildlife protection. Our organization works to patrol the forests. It's all voluntary. No one pays us anything to protect these animals. Since we started, we've seen wildlife recover to levels not seen since the late 19th century. The animals that were here then are still here now. What was it then that made Jia Shen Liu put down his gun and fight to protect forest habitats?
It was about 8 or 9 years ago. My husband brought home an animal he'd caught. It was so cute, I just couldn't. I told him I didn't want him to hunt ever again. We'd protect the animals instead, so that our children and their children could see them in the wild too. That was how we got into conservation work.
His wife's words led one-time hunter Jia Shen Liu to transform his life. There was a long and hard road ahead. For years, Jia Shen recruited Ding Ben Zai hunters to join him in the move to protect flying squirrels, with mixed results. This thankless task chipped away at initial resistance and changed the minds of many. The vibrant ecosystem on Buffalo Hill today attests to their success, the birth of Ye Maozi Forest. Located at the entrance to Buffalo Hill, Ye Maozi Forest is where the community leads regular nighttime trail walks. Less than a decade earlier, the area had fewer than 10 flying squirrels left. That number is now over 40. With the population starting to spread outwards. Such clearly positive results have further boosted local support for flying squirrel and other conservation efforts. The bamboo shoot harvest begins immediately after the spring tea harvest. Not many people know how to do this. I'm not just bragging. Cutting out a tender shoot looks easy, but actually takes time and experience to do right. If you did it, you'd cut too much out. Every year, starting in April, for about a month or two, is when we harvest shoots in our bamboo groves. The rest of the year, we leave the groves alone.
Birds and other animals play regularly around here. We interrupt them only during harvest time. Otherwise, the bamboo is undisturbed, and we only come back up here during harvest season. We often see blue pheasant and bamboo partridge around, and squirrels and white-faced flying squirrels. Macaques sometimes come down to munch. You know, we harvest bamboo shoots here, but other animals do the same thing too. When they're hungry, they know that there are edible shoots in the groves.
Day fades into night, and mists hang heavy over the silent forest. White-throated hill partridges return to their roosts to wait out the night. Nocturnal residents commence another day's activity. While different from the daytime hubbub, nocturnal activity is no less exciting. Flying squirrels are a cornerstone of nighttime forest life. Evidence of their presence abounds in Yamaozi Forest. White-faced flying squirrels are the star attraction in Ding Ben Zai's night scene. White-faced flying squirrels emerge from their nests around dusk. Hygienic to a fault, their first act of the day is to relieve themselves. Creatures of the forest, their diet consists mostly of vines, tender leaves, and tree fruit. At home in the trees, white-faced flying squirrels are well adapted to the area's deciduous and mixed forests. There are some 15 different fireflies in the Ding Ben Zai area, including huge populations of black-winged fireflies in April and May, as well as luminous glowing wild mushrooms. You can only see these between April and December. The appearance of black-winged fireflies coincides with the fruiting of mulberry trees, an opportunity for feasting never missed by white-faced flying squirrels. Guided by Jia Shen, we soon find squirrels busily gorging themselves on the plump fruit. Mulberries are a favorite food, along with the Formosa terpinea. These two are their favorites. They stuff the fruit into their mouth one after another. Look at the mouth of that one. Mulberries, one after another. Look, really beautiful. Did you see that? It's gone back up. Jia Xian has observed squirrels for years and is now intimately familiar with the nocturnal habits of seven white-faced flying squirrels in the Yamaozi Forest. Returning to their nest before dawn, they carefully clean their fur before going in. They'll rest until late afternoon and the start of another day. Any intrusion by a competitor white-faced flying squirrel is vigorously challenged. Of 2009 was the worst natural disaster to hit southern Taiwan in half a century. Torrential rains and flooding cut Ding Ben Zai's roadway links with the outside for an entire month. The first thing Jia Xin and his friends did after roads became passable was to hike into Yamaozi Forest to survey the condition of white-faced flying squirrel habitats.
Was it knocked down in the typhoon? There was a cluster of ginger rock ferns here, a big full cluster. It must have been blown away. The white-faced flying squirrel that lives here has had the most offspring so far. It's not here today. It's not that long since the typhoon, and things are still unsettled. This one's not staying here now. If it were, it would have poked its head out by now. His extended watch of white-faced flying squirrel nests reveals extensive typhoon damage and waterlogging. Most are abandoned. Jiaxian hopes to clean out some of the soaked nests and encourage the return of at least some of the squirrels. This one's way too wet. I'll use these dry leaves to clean it out. This dry bedding is for the nest. It can be used to reline a new nest. Wow, that's really wet. It's only fully soaked at the bottom. The squirrels moved out. I'll clean it up a bit and see if it returns. I'll put this dry material in here, see if I can't make it drier and more comfortable.
Okay.
To better understand the habits of the white-faced flying squirrel, Jia Xian, with the help of friends, builds an observation blind near one of the restored nests. Come over here a moment. It won't bring new material in and won't take the wet stuff out. It won't clean it on its own. Not that smart. A perfect match with the name of our community. These squirrels are ultra idiots. I've seen it a lot. They wait for nests to dry naturally before moving back in. It's not long before other animals return to Yemanzi Forest. Jia Xian steps onto hill trails with anticipation. He looks forward to checking in on his white-faced flying squirrel friends. I've seen this guy since I first began. He's still here, already been about 8 years. You see him come back last night? Did anyone see him last night? Did you? I think he might be in there. Let me go up and take a peek. Bamboo scaffolding makes for easier observation. How many years do I think he'll live? This one's been around for about 8. He abandoned his nest after Morakot. Now that we've cleaned it out, he's returned. So our survey work looks to have produced a success. He's back. I saw his eyes. Let's not bother him. Autumn casts surrounding forests in pastel colors, and terpenia fruit hangs succulent and heavy, ready to sustain squirrels through the winter. Flying squirrels live a mostly solitary existence, congregating in pairs and groups only to mate and reproduce. Here it is. They love these. The best part is the end bit here. This kudzu and its roots supply food during winter. All of this. They love to eat these roots. Is when female white-faced flying squirrels stuff their nest with new bedding. It tells Jiaxian that a new generation will soon arrive. The female invests considerable effort in finding a concealed and safe place to wait and give birth. As the warmth of spring arrives to clear away winter's chill, we see white-faced flying squirrels frolicking through the branches of this large tree. It's a juvenile, but quite big already. That's a big one, that one's small. The one that just jumped, did you see? The mother's protecting it, making sure it doesn't fall. Look, she's protecting it, worried it'll fall. Mom's brought it out to practice. They're snuggling now. It is the conservation efforts of the Ding Ben Zai community and those like Liu Jiaxian that inspire hope of a sustainable and healthy future for Ye Maozi Forest. Time and resources are needed to lift the veil of secrecy that still surrounds the life of flying squirrels. Zhuqi Lin has studied flying squirrels for more than a year. A Formosan giant flying squirrel took up residence in a research nest he'd built to observe owls. He used banding marks linked to an automatic infrared camera and GPS tracking system to track the squirrel's movements. His subsequent research provided precious insight into mating behavior. Males, he found, regularly fight to establish superiority, with victors gaining extra favor with females.
Examining an anesthetized Formosan giant flying squirrel teaches us quite a bit about its anatomy. One firm step is enough to catch hold. Look at its flat surface here. This part sticks out to let the squirrel quickly catch hold of branch surfaces. It helps make it a good climber. See the large size of its back paws? Much larger than those in the front. They're much stronger too. They're put to good use in jumping and gliding. Flying squirrels don't really fly. They use their powerful back legs and skin membranes to move through the forest. While skin membrane size factors into how far a squirrel can fly, soaring ability relies entirely on one special anatomical structure, airfoil-shaped cartilage. This is the cartilage structure right here. It helps squirrels extend their skin membrane. In general, if this was it, the dimensions would be too small, because increasing this would also increase this part. That is to say, the bigger the membrane, the better we might expect the buoyancy to be. It helps with glide. To glide, squirrels climb to the upper branches of a tree, identify their intended landing area, and jump. Once airborne, they extend all four legs and attach skin membranes outward. Membrane folds pulled taut allow squirrels to glide downward. After landing, they can climb up once again and repeat the process to continue moving across the forest canopy. Zhuqi once participated in a Ding Ben Zai night tour to watch nocturnal flying squirrels in action. After more than a year of research, he has returned at the invitation of the community with his high-tech research nest in hand. Local conservationists hope that data collected here can significantly advance community flying squirrel research efforts. We will use our accumulated experience and data to further enhance our ecological and research credentials. Now, this is the only way to keep at the forefront of this field. My research students, for example, will study flying squirrels and can use this because it has a good chance of being co-opted as a nest. We can keep it under surveillance relatively easily, much easier than we could a nest in a tree hollow. Have you ever had two squirrels or pairs share this nest? Never a male-female pair, although I've seen a mother and her young. Wow! Mother and young! The Formosan giant flying squirrel! Next morning, the Ding Ben Zai Cultural Association and Zhuqi Lin head for Yemaza Forest to install two experimental nest sites. Flying squirrels are at the core of ecotourism here in our community. Niushan is a wild forest that is well suited to supporting them. You might say it's a playground, a nirvana for squirrels. We'd like to do more to protect and extend this habitat for the benefit of both the natural ecosystem and ecotourism. It is good all around. While installing the research nest, the group found a new hairy-footed flying squirrel nest close by. The Formosan hairy-foot is the most active around the end of winter. Look at that, lots of recent use. They have a better chance of finding good nesting spots. Right, small dimension tree hollows are pretty common.
The life of the Formosan hairy-footed flying squirrel remains cloaked in mystery because of their speed. Limited research has been done, and most of what we know comes from those who've spent their lives around forests. It's hoped that current work on white-faced and Formosan giant flying squirrels will also eventually shed light on the Formosan hairyfoot. The Council of Agriculture's Taiwan Forestry Bureau began promoting community forestry programs in 2002. They encourage community development work in a way that promotes both consensus and conservation.
The citizens of Ding Ben Zai take good suggestions to heart and use them constructively. What they see as helpful, they've been very willing to adopt and make their own. They're great at putting ideas almost immediately into action. Sometimes we'll have a meeting, talk about some idea, and see it already implemented the very next week.
The exceptional conservation results of Ding Ben Zai community were honored in 2008, when it received the Executive Yuan's National Council for Sustainable Development's annual Ecotourism Hotspot Award.
We founded our cultural association in 1995 with the hope of creating long-term sustainability for our local economy. This is how we got into ecological conservation. We tied local natural and cultural advantages into opportunities for ecotourism and recreational tourism. After all these years, everyone in the community, young as well as old, is involved. Everyone agrees and supports this effort. We've got exceptionally high concurrence in terms of our environmental conservation work. This is what will make this enterprise sustainable for years and generations to come.
Thanks to the Forestry Bureau, the Ding Ben Zai Cultural Association, and people like Josh and Leo, Ding Ben Zai is today a magnet for Taiwanese eager to see flying squirrels, fireflies, and forest birds in the wild. Ding Ben Zai has also earned significant momentum for local cultural industries through a lively annual events and activities calendar. The forest beneath a warming sun absorbs essential nutrients, sustaining the foundation for life upon which we all rely. From hunters to conservationists, the citizens of Ding Ben Zai have used their intimate knowledge of flying squirrels to create a sustainable and positive model for community-based ecotourism. The folks here know that cooperation, adoption of good new ideas, and continued vigil will do more than protect the flying squirrel paradise of Ye Maozi Forest. It will help make Ding Ben Zai a good place to live and work for many generations to come, and create in these hills a nirvana for its human residents as well.